Thank you for tuning in to MacroView Television and welcome to a brand new edition of Taiwan Outlook, the program that presents the different faces and lets you hear the different voices on Taiwan. I'm your host, Wu Ruiguo. How much do you know about cloud computing? And how about big data? On today's program, we're delighted to have a true expert who has been working in the IT industry for over 30 years, Mr. David Lee, to be our special guest and talk about the state of IT industry globally. Welcome to our program, David.
Hi. It's a great pleasure to be here today.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you on the program, David.
It's my pleasure.
Yes. Well, let's start off the program by asking you to tell us a little bit about yourself. As I mentioned earlier, that David, you have been working for some of the leading IT companies in the world, including IBM, Oracle, and others. And also, you have, you know, branched out into human resources, you know, division, you know, in the sense of developing younger talents and things. And now that you are advisor to many of the leading companies in Taiwan and also sitting on some of the boards, giving advice based on your 30 plus years of experience. Please tell us a little bit about your work experience and things that you have done in the past.
Okay, my name is David Lee and I worked for IBM for 17 years in 6 months.
Okay.
My first job.
All right.
And my second job is Oracle Taiwan as a managing director for 3 years.
Good.
Then promoted to China as a China East and Western regional managing director another 3 years.
Good.
Then right. I was headhunted to DuPont China, now
okay.
called HTC China CEO.
Okay.
Okay. For another several years.
Mm-hmm.
Then back to Taiwan. And also in charge of EEEE 1111
yes.
job bank.
Yes.
Okay.
Of course.
That's my career, about 30 years in Taiwan.
Okay. And it, of course, covers not just Taiwan, yeah. Not just the IT industry, but also all over Asia region,
yeah.
Including China, of course.
Yes.
And also, like I said at the beginning,
right.
you also branch out into human resources.
Right. And currently, I'm, you know, taking a job called Yonyou.
Okay.
It's a software company.
Yes.
As a board independent board director.
Okay.
Already 4 years in China.
Terrific. And David, you have, you know, spent 30 plus years in the IT industry. We know that information technology is extremely important in the development of, you know, industries in different areas, not just, you know, IT related. Can you tell us, in your opinion, how has IT industry changed the business environment under which that we all operate?
Okay, please. I will spend about a few minutes to
please.
Elaborate more detail.
Okay.
Since 1990, internet entered into our life.
Yes.
It shortened the global distance by using internet.
Mm-hmm.
And in previous age, we used to buy the things, we go to department store. But right now, you can sit at home and just use your APP by using your mobile phone. No matter any device, any
Indeed.
Branding, you just slide your mobile phone and the goods were shipped to your home directly.
Exactly.
And also, the company can use more technology by internet and provide B2C e-commerce, so-called e-commerce.
Mm-hmm.
Allow user can buy from laptop or PC, desktop or phone.
Yes.
Any device. So technology already changed
exactly.
our behavior.
Mm-hmm. And you have been in the industry for so many years. But before 1990, the people in the industry sort of saw this was inevitable. This is something that was going to happen, especially after the advancement of the internet.
Mm-hmm.
What was the feeling back then in the 1980s? People foresaw this?
Well, people did not know that because internet is so-called disrupted technology.
Yes, yes.
They changed the game rule.
It was a game changer.
So people did not predict that would happen in 1990.
Okay, all right. And given the fact that, you know, people talk about IT, you know, industry, talk about the technological impact on the way we do things, on the way we manage our businesses, let me ask you, what is the concept of cloud computing? This has been such a, you know, hot buzzword in the last few years in Taiwan and other places. But a lot of people may not know exactly what cloud computing is. You know, what is the significance of cloud computing technologies?
Okay. Basically, cloud computing is using a technology called grid computing.
Okay.
A lot of servers integrate together as a grid computing.
Okay.
And they provide a so-called technology virtual machine, virtualization.
All right.
Just like you are using your own. Take an example. You use Google Mail, Gmail.
Yes.
I use Gmail. So it seems like I have a PC, I have a server to serve me. So basically, what I mentioned, cloud computing as using a grid computing by leveraging virtual machine and provide a shared service, shared processor, shared storage. And you can store the data, you can access the data in anywhere, in any time, via any device.
Okay, so these are the major advantages of, you know, cloud computing. But what are some of the disadvantages of cloud computing?
Okay, well, I have to add some more in advantage because cloud computing provides enterprise cooperation. You don't have to pay a lot. You don't have to hire the people. And you can use it whenever you need it. So flexibility, more flexibility, scalability. A second, lower cost. You don't have to pay more upfront. You can pay whenever you need more storage, whenever you need more server. So you don't have to maintain the software. You don't have to maintain the hardware. So the cost will be lower. But for the disadvantage for big data, because data is installed, is stored in a public area, a data center. So when high hacker come in or any cyber attack, it probably will impact your usage. But again, for the system you install at your home or your company, probably you still facing, you will be facing the same problem, the hacker cyber attack to penetrate your system.
All right. Let me ask you, what is the demand among the industries in Taiwan and elsewhere about cloud computing? Is there a lot of demand for more storage space from companies and enterprises alike?
From the current observation worldwide, every company is selling cloud, including IBM. Recently, the big change moved to cloud computing. And Oracle, and Amazon, HP, all the company spend their money, invest in the cloud computing. And why? Because people want to lower down the cost. So, so that would be a trend to using the cloud computing. Let me take one example. One of the company, Oracle, they are providing recruiting. You just type few key description for job description for the applicant. And they automatically link to LinkedIn and provide the right candidate to you. You pay less money. So it's amazing. So the competition become more stronger for like a 1111 or 104 on job, you know, bank. So that would be very, very, you know, very strong competition will happen, including the headhunter and online job bank. So all the software company sell by using cloud.
Another reason maybe for some of the major companies, like you mentioned, the Oracle, Microsoft, Google, everybody getting to, you know, cloud computing is because it's profitable. You know, using the example that I have, you know, with me, Amazon Web Services. Apparently, in the year 2017, the estimate is it's going to bring in $8.2 billion in revenue. Oh, David, that's a lot of money. I mean, is that also because there's a lot of demand? That's why a lot of people are getting into it, you know, because simply it's profitable. What do you think?
Indeed, it's very profitable. And nowadays, Amazon provide more services. Now, I can share with the audience that cloud computing will be three layers. First layer is called infrastructure as a service. They call IaaS. The second one is platform as a services called PaaS.
Okay.
The higher level is called SaaS, S-A-A-S.
It's called
Software as a Services.
Okay.
So let me elaborate more detail is for the lower level, just like a data center.
Yes.
Data center, you provide hardware to you, infrastructure, communication. Storage server, that is called ICE.
Okay.
Infrastructure as a service. So people, you can rent a machine. Mm. You can rent the software.
Okay.
And infrastructure is a lower level.
Okay.
Platform as a service is second layer.
Mm.
So people, you develop your software and your software install at the second layer.
Okay.
And third layers is you don't have to install software. You don't have to install application. Develop a software application. You just go and use, just like a water or electricity.
Mm.
You just turn on the tap, the water come out.
Okay.
So the third level is application. So software as a service.
Okay.
Take an example, the most hot company called Salesforce.com. They provide CRM.
Mm. Okay.
So it's a ready application, allow user immediately to use. When your company making money, you can pay more. When your company losing money, you don't want to have so many users, lower down the cost.
Right.
So three layers.
Yeah, it's very dynamic.
Yes.
Exactly. Thank you, David, for giving us the very comprehensive background about what cloud computing is. We need to take the first break on our program today. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the second segment of today's program here on Taiwan Outlook. I'm your host, Ray Guo. Well, we'll continue our conversation with Mr. David Lee, who's currently an independent board director of Yonyou Software Company. And we're delighted to have David on the program today, where we'll continue our discussion about IT industry, big data, and also cloud computing. David, we mentioned earlier in the first part of the program that many of the leading players in IT industry, including Google, Apple, Oracle, Microsoft, they're all getting into, cloud computing. Of course, it's a very lucrative, very attractive in terms of the amount of revenues they can bring in. But what is the overall picture of cloud computing industry today, given the fact that, so many of the big players want to get into the industry, then where are the business opportunities? I mean, they are competing against each other. They're all big boys of the industry. What do you think the business opportunities are?
Okay, the business opportunity for the cloud computing is huge.
Everywhere?
Yes. Okay. And basically, it depends on each player.
Okay.
What layer they want to play. Okay. As I mentioned, they want to penetrate the ICE or platform as a service PaaS or SaaS. So different vendor provide different platform solution.
Okay.
And the business will be huge in the next 10 years.
Okay. And given the fact that, you have already all these, big players in the, marketplace, is there any opportunities for some of the smaller and medium-sized enterprises like in Taiwan, not just into, get into, the cloud computing, infrastructure, building, because you can't compete. But what are some of the opportunities for Taiwan's small and medium-sized enterprises?
Okay.
Please.
Basically, cloud computing provides a service targeting for small and medium.
The reason
why they want to provide to small and medium because the company cannot hire too many IT people.
No.
It's cost high, and they are unable to provide human resources for the DP manager, DP staff, as well as those hardware, software device cost.
Designers,
so they want to, by using lower cost, and cloud computing provide cheaper way, lower cost to those small and medium customers. So that's why so many key players, they want to eat those pie, those market.
Okay. And so some people will say, after observing the IT industry, saying that, hey, David, in the IT industry, the bigger, the better. If you are big, you're a major player, you come into cloud computing, for example, then you're able to have a presence, you have a place in the marketplace. Do you agree with such an assertion?
I agree, because for the key player for cloud computing, they have to spend initially huge money in building the infrastructure.
Yes.
Like a data center, you have to pay air condition, you know, and also electricity and the space. Huge and worldwide.
I can imagine.
And server. So it is not for a small company or medium company, they can afford. Like Amazon, they invest a lot of money in worldwide for all the data center, hardware, software devices.
Okay.
Cost a fortune.
Okay. And we also understand in cloud computing, currently comes in four different forms: public, private, hybrid, and also community. Could you please elaborate on the differences and the purpose for each of the four forms?
Let's talk about public first.
Okay.
Public cloud means they allow all the people, everybody. Okay, like a Salesforce.com, they provide to the enterprise CRM. Okay. All the information you can update to there, that is called public.
Right.
Anybody can come here. Okay. And private, they are quite concerned about security.
Exactly.
Like government and banking industry, they do not allow, they do not want to release to public.
Of course.
So they call public, only internally public.
Okay.
Allow certain people, the private.
Okay.
They are quite frightened about the security.
Very low key.
Yeah. And the third one, the form, is hybrid, which means a public and private.
Okay. Together.
Together. Right. So some bank, they can allow, like exchange rate, I can allow public to access. But those are not highly confidential or classified confidential information they were allowed to use in public.
Okay.
So public and private combined called hybrid. And the last one form is called a community, which a certain people in same community or a small company, small community, they can establish a cloud computing they use by themselves.
Oh,
okay. So basically, four forms currently.
Okay. All right, with the four forms available, how do you think that cloud computing is now changing the way, not just how businesses conduct themselves, but how we as individuals, you know, relate to each other and conduct our daily business? For example, if I go to the bank, make a deposit or withdraw, how is that different now with cloud computing technologies available?
Okay. In the future, actually, right now, you can use cloud to do something,
of course.
Like O2O, online to offline.
Okay.
In China, Taiwan not yet start.
Okay.
In China, you already can use your mobile phone to purchase something, and you go to like 85C to buy the bread and cake.
Okay.
And your mobile phone can guide it to buy that. Okay. And the third party, the payment gateway, receive the money. And you go to the shop to pick up, take away your coffee and cake. So that is cloud computing.
Of course.
And for the catering, the store or restaurant, they don't have to pay the money by the POS equipment.
No.
The cloud center will pay the money to buy the POS, POS, software and hardware. And the company, the restaurant, just pay monthly fee to the cloud center.
Exactly.
So that is type of cloud.
Okay.
And also, a lot of company, they provide outlet to sell. Physical people come to your outlet to buy the thing. They also, they provide the internet, e-commerce, allow user buy things from apps, buy things from your app, or your desktop or notebook or PC, whatever, that is also a type of cloud.
Okay.
And also we are using the Gmail, Yahoo Mail.
Yes.
It's all
part
cloud.
Of the cloud. Okay.
Right.
And David, you know, one thing a lot of people will ask is, sure, I mean, I understand that cloud computing offers many advantages and also convenience. But, you know, I'm kind of worried about security. You know, if I'm the owner of a small and medium-sized enterprise, I buy the service, you know, cloud computing service from Amazon, for example. I pay a fee. I don't need to invest to build up my own infrastructure. I pay a fee every month. But what if my, you know, business, you know, information, you know, some of which are confidential, you know, it stores up in the cloud and somehow, you know, the information is breached. Yeah. You know, somebody hacked into it and some of the information became available. It shouldn't have been. You know, what is your, you know, observation about the state of, you know, cloud computing security? Because we also remember last year, 2014, there was a huge controversy, you know, regarding Apple's iCloud. You know, when some of the better-known celebrities in Hollywood had their private pictures, you know, I mean, stored in the iCloud, and somehow, you know, the hackers were able to, you know, breach into it. And so it raised a concern about storing some of the information, private information especially, that you have up in the cloud. What is your view about security?
Based on my experience in the previous 30 years,
yes,
I truly believe no matter your data or your software installed, we call on-premise, which is on your company site, and you should aware of that. Should be aware of that. Your employee probably will steal your data, right?
Okay.
So on the other hand, the cyber attack or hacker. They might penetrate to Yahoo or Google or Apple. But I truly believe those cloud computing center, they set more layers firewall to prevent it happened. However, some of the people, they want to just become famous. So they try to break through. They try to penetrate. So we call this cyber attack or hacker to penetrate. But from my personal point of view, I truly believe, even though if you put your own software at your company, you still worry about your people, steal your data. Also, you have to, as well as you have to worry about the hacker or cyber attack to penetrate to your company because you spend less money than those Facebook, those Google, those bigger company. I truly believe. So I do not see any big issue or exposure in using the cloud computing center.
Okay, and if I were, you know, running a business and if I use the cloud computing service from one of the major players, what would be some of the recommended steps that you can make to me as the owner of my own business that I can do in addition to the kind of security measures that some of the service providers provide? You know, for example, what you mentioned, you know, monitor your employees, they do not steal data. What are some of the things, other things, maybe I can be aware of?
Okay. If you want to use the cloud computing, then you have to bear in mind that when you sign a contract with the vendor,
service provider,
then you have the list on detailed, as detailed as possible about the service level agreement, such as within 1 year, the service cannot downtime within certain minutes. And backup recovery when. So that's very key. And you have to provide me the login part, all the log. People who enter my system. How many times. So you have to list down in your service level agreement to ensure everything on the right track.
Everything regarding your company's protected.
Security.
Exactly.
And everything.
Good. And David, what we're talking about cloud computing, you gave us a very comprehensive overview of the application, about the nature, about the kinds of services that cloud computing does offer. Next, let's move on to a connected, you know, subject, which is big data. A lot of people have been talking about big data, and big data concept has actually been around for a few years. And it recently became a very hot issue in Taiwan because of the end of the year election in 2014. Specifically, with reference to the election of Taipei Mayor Ke Wen-je, and apparently his staff used a lot of the big data to analyze voter behavior. And given the fact, you know, big data is now a very hot issue. What is big data, if I may ask you? And what are some of the advantages of big data? And where are some of the applications for big data? Please, David.
Okay. Big data, by definition, they have four V.
Okay. Four Vs.
First V is volume.
Good.
Big volume.
All right.
Many, many different data set.
Okay.
So first V is volume.
Good.
Okay. So big data, by definition, volume.
Okay.
Second, velocity.
Okay.
Velocity, the second V, stands for velocity.
Mm.
Velocity means data in motion. They move very quick.
Okay.
Okay. So first, second V is velocity.
Good.
Okay. V-A-L-O-C-I-T-Y, velocity.
Mm. Mm.
The third V stands for variety. The data in many different forms.
Mm.
What does that mean?
Mm.
Photo, image, structure.
Mm.
Unstructured form.
Okay.
So all different variety form. So that is the third V, stands for variety.
Okay.
The fourth V called veracity, V-A-R-A-C-I-T-Y.
Mm-hmm.
Veracity means data in doubt.
Okay.
What does that mean, data in doubt? Because they are huge data.
Okay.
But we don't know the data is... It's right data or wrong data. For example, if you are doing customer survey to the customer, if you are sending the survey form to the wrong customer, then back the data is wrong.
Yeah.
You send
Little
to the
use.
Wrong target.
Yes.
So the false V, veracity, is data in doubt.
Okay.
So big data is very, very complicated.
Yes.
And you have to analyzing them from data, become analyzed, become useful information.
Of course.
Then people use those useful information to take right action.
Okay.
So that is big data.
All right. Let me ask you, David, you are a consultant to many of the leading industries globally and also in Taiwan. What are some of the examples that you can share with us where, you know, companies use big data to change the way they market or produce their products and services? Please.
Okay. I can cite several references.
Please.
The first one, Walmart. They analyze consumer buying behavior, then sending the right promotion.
Okay.
For example, they analyze a client, a consumer, buying a large volume detergent. So that when they have a promotion for detergent, then they send to the right people based on what they purchase record.
Exactly.
Then they send the promotion later and coupon to the target potential buyer for detergent.
Good.
Instead of in the previous, they just send to everybody, generically.
Yes. Yes.
That is useless.
No.
Waste money, waste time. So big data help the people to sell to the right target customer, right TA, target audience.
Okay, all right.
Same to the banking. Banking, they provide, analyze the client behavior based on credit card. And all the record in the credit card, what item they purchase. For example, they buy Louis Vuitton.
Okay.
So credit card company can work with Louis Vuitton to provide selling the product he want to buy or she want to buy.
Okay, good.
And let's take some more example for retail convenience store.
Please.
The POS system, point of sale, so in the point of sale system, they feedback the information to logistics. So the trucker send the right product for the certain area, 7-Eleven or Lawson or any convenience store.
Good.
So the car will send the right product commodity to that certain convenience store.
Okay.
And POS feedback, information feedback to logistic.
Okay.
And logistic feedback the information to the manufacturing.
Yes.
So that is a chain. So that information through, you know, feedback to, I say, the POS feedback to logistic feedback to manufacturing. So that we can decide which product best sell in that certain area. The civilian, like which type of bread, which type of egg. For example, tomorrow will be a typhoon.
Okay.
Then the truck will send battery, raincoat, related product, very smart, to the convenience store. And convenience store can sell more right product.
Okay.
So big data help the people to analyze the behavior, predict the tomorrow things.
Okay. And David, let me ask you, and if you continue the application for big data, would you foresee that maybe in the future or the near future, that people are going to be, you know, making their decision, you know, business decision or purchasing decisions purely on what the big data tells them to do? You know, for example, what you said about convenience store, you know, the corporate headquarters may, you know, based on the big data analysis and decide that which product to be stocked up with a typhoon coming, for example. Mm-hmm. And would that be, you know, the trend of the future where big data becomes important part and indispensable part of corporate decision making?
Indeed, yes. The answer is yes. Uh-huh. Because if you're a corporate company CEO, if you don't grab the information and your competitor grab those information and analyze, and you take the strategy, make up the strategy, decide a strategy, right strategy.
Okay.
And if you don't do that, your competitor did that, and your strategy will be wrong. His strategy will be right. So basically, remember, those data become useful information. Then useful information help us to make decision, right decision.
Exactly. All right. And David, you often mention in your speeches that the founder of Alibaba Holdings Group, Mr. Ma Yun, is a very successful example of big data.
Yes.
What do you mean by that? Could you elaborate for us?
Okay. Actually, Alibaba Tianmao, they provide the best services is the big data. Alibaba Holding Company, they analyze all the vendor on the share, what they purchase, the client from each individual store.
Okay.
And by industry, for example, for the pencil, pencil shops, they sell maybe 200 or 300 shops selling on the shelf, the store.
All right.
They sell the pencil, just one pencil, how many pencils they sold out, and sell to where, and each year volume, and you are number 10 or number 9, and where is your positioning? So people, they will see, wow, this is information is so precious because they collect all the pencil on Alibaba vendor. And my part is occupied. What percentage among all the 300 shops? So you will pay the money to buy those data, useful information.
Right.
So that's why Alibaba make a lot of money. They are selling high volume.
Yes.
High price.
Yeah. They know exactly where their potential customers want.
Exactly. Because their back end, they analyze all the commodities sell to where.
Okay.
For example, all the 300 pencil shops.
Okay.
The year volume, what? How much money?
Okay.
How
yes.
many pencils being sold to North America, to Europe, to South Africa, etc., etc. So you would be interested to buy that data. Useful information.
Yes. Finally, before we end this part of the program, David, would you think that the market size also has something to do with it? Because Taiwan is very small. We only have about 23 million consumers, and we can't compete with China. We can't compete with other bigger markets in Southeast Asia. Do you think that becomes a somewhat of a barrier, somewhat of an obstacle in terms of Taiwan's company trying to use more on the big data to expand the market, to be more efficient in providing the products and services? What do you think?
Taiwan is small, but it doesn't matter. It does not relate to small or large. As long as you're running the company, you do need the big data to analyze, to help you.
Oh, okay.
So it doesn't relate to big
not
market.
Size per se.
Correct.
Okay. So,
but I do believe that Taiwan people should, more young people to create this company to doing the big data. And help the China. That is a good business for young people to innovation, you know, create a company.
Yeah, terrific. David, you've given us free advice. Yes. We need to get the final break on the program today. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the final part of today's program here on Taiwan Outlook. I'm your host, Wu Reiguo. We will continue and hopefully wrap up this fascinating conversation with Mr. David Lee, who is currently independent board member of the Yonyou Software Company. David, what we're talking about, you know, big data, it's very exciting, very attractive. And can you tell us in this final part of the program, what are some of the possible applications that we can see in the future? You know, for example, based on analyses of big data, the corporations can make better business decisions. What else?
Okay.
What can we expect?
Okay. Right now, everybody is using a so-called social network like a Facebook.
Exactly.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And WeChat. So, QQ.
Mm-hmm.
So, nowadays, in the United States, they already developed software called social listening.
Okay.
And what does that mean is, a person is complaining a company. For example, a company, your product is very lousy.
Okay.
So they complain in the Facebook.
Okay.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So the software, if your company installed that software, social listening software,
okay,
and they can listening who is complaining our company product. And they collect all the information, analyze. Where is that client complaining?
Okay.
And they can do the proper action.
All right.
So it's already in the market.
Okay.
But Taiwan, due to we are Chinese, now it's English version. They are migrate to national languages such as Chinese.
Okay.
Because Chinese is different from English.
Yeah.
Because I hate you, hate. Uh-huh. You know, we know that.
Yes.
But in Mandarin, 我讨厌你, whatever, different tone.
Yes.
It's different dialogue.
To pick
it's
up.
Very hard to develop a Chinese, particularly in China, because of the language.
Yes. Uh-huh. And David, we know big data is being applied in many different, you know, industries. For example, we talked earlier about the application of big data in election campaigns.
Mm-hmm.
And can you give us some other examples where big data was applied,
okay.
please?
Mm-hmm. I can share with you one is in 2012, Olympic Games in London.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Olympic Games in London, they provide very high technology, big data, to analyze all the audience and the traffic situation to allow the visitor, allow the audience to take which subway, which tube is better, is more convenient.
Okay.
So that do not let a place the traffic become a big problem.
Okay.
So by using the big data,
yes.
on top of that, they provide all the online, the Olympic game, the status.
Okay.
So people can use information to see and discuss. So, I mean, big data help a lot.
Exactly.
And the other case is Cincinnati Zoo.
Okay.
They used
what
to be,
did they do?
They used to losing money. However, they're using the big data to provide the target audience to sell, to promote, making money, Cincinnati.
All right. Okay. And given the fact that there are so many applications, you know, for big data, what are some of the, on the flip side, what are some of the problems and disadvantage of, you know, big data? For example, a lot of people will say that if I rely on big data and analyze what the customers want, what they likely, you know, want the changes be in our products and services, then you will necessarily or invariably, you know, discourage your employees to try to innovate, to try to create more competitive services or products to consumers. Do you agree with such assertion?
Yeah, basically, I would like to share is big data right now is using a technology called Hadoop.
Okay.
But in the market, there are not so many Hadoop certified people exist.
Okay.
So this advantage is using big data. We require large demand those people, those type of people. But as I know, Taiwan only about 20 people certified.
Really?
Hadoop, with Hadoop, very good
very limited,
skilled.
Yes.
So if people using the Hadoop, they don't have enough people.
No.
So why big data is hard, but cannot find enough skillful people to do it.
Okay. And what do you think that in terms of educating the younger people who might be interested in the IT industry, what are some of the programs that you can recommend?
Okay. I suggest right now, the education, Minister of Education already start. Dongwu Shuzhou University already start. The first one, big data.
Okay.
To major in big data. Oh. I hope that more university establish this department to train more people in big data.
Okay.
And I truly believe Taiwan is a small island. We can create more Hadoop people to do the big data or young people to create his own company to doing the big data
analysis.
Yes, yeah, analysis.
Okay, and David, we know that you have been involved also in the human resource area, and then you were one time the executive director of the 1111 job bank online online job bank, and what do you think is the quality of our skilled personnel? Whether it's in terms of manufacturing, in terms of management, in terms of innovation. What do you think, about our education system? Are we really producing the kind of skilled personnel that the industries really need? You mentioned about Suzhou University, offering, majors in big data. Are we really producing the kinds of people that we need for Taiwan to move into the next stage of economic development?
Okay, basically, I already suggest, give the Ministry of Education a few suggestions as
please.
Taiwan currently is a problem, unemployment rate so high because of we are in so-called structure unemployment.
Okay.
What does that mean, structure unemployment? Is what we train the people in university is not the enterprise
employable.
People need.
Okay.
So we have to allow young people, maybe 1 year or 6 months, go to assigned field, not in a university.
No.
Go to the field. And also, we have to predict what about the next 5 years demand in the job market.
Okay.
Then the university established those departments to fulfill the industry requirement.
Okay.
But right now, supply and demand. It's not matched. It's mismatched.
Okay.
So that many people want to find a job and many enterprises cannot find a job.
Okay.
So it is called structure unemployment.
Okay. And we're also been talking about the different kinds of software technologies available in the program today, cloud computing, big data. And you have also mentioned that there's a lot of interest and excitement surrounding, for example, newer generation of hardware devices, no longer just tablet computers, smartphones, but also wearable devices.
Yep.
Can you tell us a little bit about your observation and prediction of the marketplace?
Okay, in the very near future, it will happen to us, around us, is IoT, Internet of Things.
Yes.
Object talk to object, machine talk to machine.
Okay.
Very near future, very quick, by using sensor. Okay, or smart home. You can use a mobile phone to trigger on, switch on air condition, electricity, anything.
Yeah.
Okay, so that is happening already last year. But this year is going to implement it in several areas. Mm-hmm. So IoT will be very key. Okay.
Indeed.
And IoT for the next 2 years probably will become IOE, Internet of Everything.
Okay, all right.
Everything, not Internet of Things.
Okay.
Internet of Everything. And also the other topic, as you mentioned, subject is a wearable device.
Okay.
That is the future.
Okay.
Okay.
Like
no matter
Apple Watch.
In the wrist or in the finger or on the head or on your hand, whatever wearable device.
Okay. And finally, before we end today's program, David, you've been working in Taiwan and in China for many years. What is the observation that you have in your private capacity as to some of the things that we can do in Taiwan to help us remain economically viable and competitive? A government talks about the need for us to be regionally integrated. And we have, of course, signed ECFA with China. But the subsequent agreements, including the cross-strait service trade pact, is still stalled in the legislature. Mm-hmm. So what would be some of the things that you can recommend, in terms of, making Taiwan, not just talking about the economic glory days of the 1960s and 70s, but talk about what will, we can do in 2015 and beyond. Okay. What can we help ourselves?
Okay. The key thing is MOEA must clearly state it. Mm-hmm. What are those key industries they want to focus?
Good.
And right now, MOEA only sponsors subsidize big enterprise. From my point of view, they should not invest too much money into those big enterprise.
Okay.
They should subsidize young people to establish company, to make their dream come true.
Okay.
Such as big data, software, internet related. Oh, innovation.
All right.
And Taiwan young people, they doesn't want to, create a company by themselves. They just want to find a job. Oh. That is no good.
No.
We need more garage,
to produce new
entrepreneurship.
Yes. Okay. So these are the very sound recommendations that you can make. Thank you very much, David, for being a special guest on our program today. I certainly want to wish you all the best in your future personal and professional endeavors. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for watching our program today. I'll see you next time on MacroView Television. Thank you.